Well, good morning. Welcome to this week's online service from Beacon Lough Baptist Church here in Gateshead. It is, as always, good to be back with you all. And whatever kind of week you've had, I'd like to invite you to join us as we come together into the presence of Almighty God. John Kitson will be sharing with us later on some more from our series on the essential Jesus. I'd like to start our time together by reading Psalm 130. Out of the depths I cry to you, Lord. Lord, hear my voice. Let your ears be attentive to my cry for mercy. If you, Lord, kept a record of sins, Lord, who could stand? But with you there is forgiveness, so that we can, with reverence, serve you. I wait for the Lord. My whole being waits, and in his word I put my hope. I wait for the Lord more than watchmen wait for the morning, more than watchmen wait for the morning. Israel, put your hope in the Lord, for with the Lord is unfailing love, and with him is full redemption. He himself will redeem Israel from all their sins. O God, from whom every gift derives, we gather to worship you this day. You are an awesome God, greater than our comprehension or our imagination. You are beyond any word we could ever use to describe you. And yet, through Jesus, we know the intimacy of your vast love. We come to you in thanksgiving and praise to know that you are God, and to place our lives anew into your hands. Enlarge our vision this hour with your word. Instill in us again your hope in place of our despair. Your peace where our hatred threatens. Your joy amidst our depression. Your love overwhelming our apathy. May your Holy Spirit surround and indwell us now and forevermore. In Jesus we pray. Amen.
Thank you.
I'd like to leave us now in a prayer of thanks. Heavenly Father, how can we ever thank you enough? We look back over the past week and remember your countless blessings. Thank you for your abundant, abounding grace. Thank you that this morning we can come and drink from the water of life, your word. Thank you for your unexpected, unmerited favour that you shower upon our lives every day. Thank you for your Son, for the Holy Spirit, and the gift of eternal life. Help us today to stand in faith and keep our focus on you. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
When I fear my faith will fail, Christ will hold me fast. When the tempter would prevail, he will hold me fast. I could never keep my hope through justice has been satisfied. He will hold me fast. Raise with him to endless life. He will hold me fast till our faith is turned to sight. When he comes at last, he will hold.
So last Monday, as you might remember, was the longest day. How long is the longest day? Well, apparently it's 16 hours and 38 minutes of sunshine. And if you live on the East Coast like us, if you go to the coast, you can often see the sunset across the sea. And that's what I did this week. I went to St. Mary's Lighthouse and filmed the sunset. You can see it on the screen now. Often, as one watches a sunset, it can be a time just to pause, to reflect and pray. It's a space, a moment when you can stop the world, get off just for a little bit. So this morning I'd like to replicate that experience. I want to give you a moment to be still. It's probably going to be about 2 minutes silence, and you can just hear the waves in the distance. In this moment, just come to God, bring to Him the things that are on your heart.
Sometimes it's moments of brokenness which create the greatest transformations. Times where fear gives birth to faith, pain leads to healing, and chaos dissolves into peace. It's in these times we often see God more clearly. For in our deepest turmoil, He remains faithful. When our spirit is crushed, He remains strong. When our moment is too heavy, He carries the burden. As gold is refined by fire, we too are often refined by struggle. It's part of growing, changing, becoming. Lately, the journey has been difficult. Our breath has been labored. Our steps uneasy. But we stand in faith, knowing who is leading us through this desert. The God of peace, the God of hope, the God of restoration.
Dear Heavenly Father, we come to you in prayer, acknowledging our needs, our hopes, and praying that you will meet us where we are today. Scripture commands us to pray continually and give thanks in all circumstances. So we ask you to give us a heart that is thankful in all circumstances, even the ones we don't understand. As we pray, we ask you to fill our hearts with hope. We thank you that you are in control of all things and that nothing is too difficult for you. Lord Jesus, help us to love you and trust you. As our love grows for you, so help us to develop and maintain our trust in you. Help us to love you all the more because your word says you are a loving Father. Lord, in your presence is fullness of joy. At your right hand there are pleasures forever. Thank you that whenever suffering is present, you are there with us to show us how to be more like you through it. Help us not to focus on the hardships, but on the divine opportunity to become more like your Son. We acknowledge that our hope is not in our circumstances, but in you and your word. We pray that it will sustain us, guide us, and give us wisdom in the midst of all that is happening around us. Heavenly Father, whatever our circumstances are today, we pray that we will know your reassuring presence, sense your joy, and rejoice in knowing that you will always care for us. Scripture tells us, if you believe, you will receive whatever you ask for in prayer. So, Lord, we maintain our hope in you and hold on to the assurance that what we are praying for is already accomplished in the name of Jesus, and in his name, we lift our prayers to you. Amen.
When Hello, it's really good to be joining with you in spirit, if not in person today, here from Bill Key. I send greetings from our household, from Jane and Daniel. It's been a bit of a tough week with both Jane and Dan testing positive for COVID-19, and then they've not been too well this week. So if I'm not at my peak, I apologise. I've been doing my best to look out and look after them. But it is still a great pleasure to be able to share with you this morning. Our reading is from Luke chapter 18, and we're going to be reading verses 9 through to 14. To some who were confident of their own righteousness and looked down on everybody else, Jesus told this parable. Two men went up to the temple to pray, one a Pharisee and one a tax collector. The Pharisee stood up and prayed about himself. God, I thank you that I am not like other men, robbers, evildoers, adulterers, or even like this tax collector. I fast twice a week and give a tenth of all I have. But the tax collector stood at a distance. He would not even look up to heaven, but he beat his breast and said, God, have mercy on me, a sinner. I tell you that this man, rather than the other, went home justified before God. For everyone who exalts himself will be humbled, and he who humbles himself will be exalted. It's been said often enough that one of the great problems in reading the parables of Jesus today is the difficulty of recovering the shock factor that they undoubtedly possessed for Jesus' original hearers. Too often, familiarity with these stories has disarmed us of their punch, deprived us of the sting in the tail, if you like. Take the story of the Good Samaritan. The very word Samaritan conjures up to us a picture of goodness and helpfulness. So when Jesus tells us it was a Samaritan that stopped to help the injured man, we're not really surprised, still less outraged. There's no sharp intake of breath at the mere mention of the word, as there certainly would have been when the parable was first told. The hammer blows that the parable delivers to the prejudice of Jesus' original hearers are reduced for us to the caress of a reassuring feather. We know all about Good Samaritans. And even more is true with the parable with which we're looking at together today. Think about it for a moment. Two men went up to the temple to pray. Now, surely that's a good thing in the eyes of us all, or so we would assume on the surface anyway. Both came to pray, and both went home believing sincerely that they had prayed. Yet the extraordinary lesson is that while one of them truly did have dealings with God in his devotions that day, the other, in spite of his apparent good intentions, was conducting a monologue the whole time that he was in the temple. The text our translation gives around this, prayed about himself in verse 11, could equally be translated prayed to himself. This prayer indeed was a monologue. And that alone should be enough to worry us, shouldn't it, really? Yet Jesus says in his parable that it's possible to come to church thinking that you want to meet with God and leave believing that you've done so, and all the time deceive yourself. Now, what a challenge that is to each and every one of us. This is one parable then that the shock factor of which we just can't afford to miss. Jesus has got something vital to teach us here about the whole nature of religion, of prayer, of guilt, of righteousness. And we mustn't let our 21st century images of Pharisees and tax collectors blunt the impact of his warnings. So let's try hard together this morning to get under the surface of this parable, into the shoes of Jesus' original audience, and benefit from it. So first, let's ask a question. What was so wrong with the Pharisees' prayer and so right about the tax man's prayer? Yeah, because God's assessment of them is so widely different, maybe from our expectations. But really, if we look, it's not too difficult to spot. Notice how the Pharisee begins his prayer. Lord, he says, I thank you that I am not like other men. Can you imagine a man going to visit his doctor? And he says, Doctor, I'm in perfect health. Everything functions absolutely perfectly. Do you know what? I'm absolutely tip top. I am A1 as I sit here before you today. No infections, no diseases, no ailments, nothing. In short, unlike all the other miserable specimens out there in your waiting room, there's absolutely nothing wrong with me at all. What could a doctor do for such a man? He would leave the surgery completely unchanged. There's little point really of him visiting at all, except to parade himself as a one-man medical marvel. But he could receive nothing because he asked for nothing, because he doesn't feel a need. But maybe if he'd allowed the doctor to examine him, his confidence may have been dented somewhat. Well, your blood pressure's a bit high. And did you know that you're showing the early signs of being a diabetic? But such is a man of this type's complacency. He never invites such an examination. He feels no real need, and so his visit is a complete waste of his and the doctor's time. This is exactly the point, I guess, that Jesus is making in another saying, back in Matthew chapter 9 and verse 12, where he says, it is not the healthy who need a doctor, but the sick. This Pharisee is a perfect example of that observation. He came into the temple to congratulate himself on his spiritual and moral health. He was just an exhibitionist who was boasting. Nothing more, nothing less. More than that, I suspect the tax man knew for whose benefit the Pharisee's prayer was. He overheard him, of course. It would be difficult for him not to. God, I thank you, said the Pharisee loudly, that I am not like other men, rogues, swindlers, traitors, are that tax man over there. It was an obvious dig at him. But he was used to such abuse, so it didn't bother him. He knew he deserved it, to be fair. He was under no illusions about his moral and spiritual condition. And for this reason, his prayer could not be more different. There's no self-congratulatory words or mock gratitude. He feels his need. He beats his breast. A gesture no Jew made except in times of profound emotional distress. It burst out of him in three gasps of inner despair. God, be merciful to me, the sinner. That's what he says, literally, the sinner. For at that moment, he feels like the only sinner in the entire universe. Yet, says Jesus, that's the kind of prayer God hears. That sort of worshipper goes home a different person. Whereas the proud and complacent, for all their boasts and fine wordsmanship, leave the house of God in exactly the same unacceptable state in which they arrived. I recall Mary's words in Luke chapter 1 and verse 53. He has filled the hungry with good things, but has sent the rich away empty. This is all about the question of personal felt need. You see, fundamentally, the difference between these two was the grounds upon which they sought acquittal in the eyes of God. The Pharisees was one of those who, Luke observes, were confident of their own righteousness and looked down on everybody else, he tells us in verse 9. He could make it to heaven by his own efforts. He'd have nothing to be ashamed of before God and his tribunal. Why, he's able here to boast about it, about how hard he's worked to get there. But verse 14 of chapter 18 reminds us, everyone who exalts himself will be humbled, and he who humbles himself will be exalted. It was conceit that laid at the root of the Pharisees' religion. He wanted to get to heaven with his dignity intact. He wanted to go through those pearly gates with his head held high. He wanted a righteousness that he could be proud of. But you know what? No such righteousness exists. God has an unchanging policy. Everyone who exalts himself will be humbled. This is the essential lesson of Jesus' own example. He accepts the title Lord, but he takes the role of a servant. He shares equality with God, but he hangs voluntarily on a cross. No wonder he offended and perplexed people. You see, in those days, humility was a vice. It was a despicable sign of weakness. Yet Jesus insists that not only must we be humble, he reveals that the heart of God himself is humble. No wonder then this Pharisee can't go to heaven. He had no idea what humility was. By contrast, for the taxman, it was his only hope. God, have mercy on me, a sinner, he says in verse 13. Mercy is a weak translation in our text. It's not the normal word for mercy. In fact, to translate something close to the original, I've got to try and go a little bit old school. Something like be appropriated or conciliated towards me would be a bit closer to the original. You see, the word was associated with the sacrificial ritual of the temple and had to do with the atonement of sins. The taxman's hope is not just in God's loving and compassionate character, you see. Remember where he is. His eyes are on the altar where the temple priest at the hour of prayer has just offered sacrifice for the forgiveness of sins for the people. "Please, God," he says, "I see the bloodstains there on the altar. Accept that sacrifice on my behalf. Be propitiated towards me." He's not just appealing to God's better nature when he says, "Be merciful to me." He's laying claim to God's own remedy for the sinner's plight. And in doing so, he highlights one more vital lesson that we can all too easily forget. There can be no real assurance of pardon without an act of atonement that satisfies God. Some people think that forgiveness is easy for God. "Of course God will forgive me. That's the business that he's in." But you know, it's dreadfully hard for God to forgive our sin. Forgiveness may be offered freely in the Bible, but please never make the mistake of thinking it's cheap. The Bible knows nothing of cheap forgiveness. And our taxman realised that. "Oh God, have mercy on me. Let my sin be atoned for. I don't minimise the seriousness of my crime. I don't underestimate the penalty that they deserve. I see the blood. I know the cost. So please, God, turn your anger away from me. Be satisfied with the sacrificial substitute that has died on the altar in my place, and have mercy on me, the sinner." So what is Jesus teaching us? What is the thrust of this parable? What should we be asking ourselves? I think we need to ask, have we stood where the taxman stood? With all the defensive masks removed, all pretense of self-righteousness abandoned. Have we looked to a sacrifice where the taxman looked? To a sacrifice, but to a far more noble and more costly sacrifice than was ever slain on a temple altar. We must look to a cross where the Son of God himself shed his blood once and for all to make atonement for the sin of the world. And we must pray as the taxman prayed, "God, have mercy on me. I ask for no cheap forgiveness. I do not underestimate the seriousness of my crime. I know that the penalty of my sin is death. But please, God, be satisfied that a worthy substitute has paid the price in my place, and so be merciful to me, the sinner." And you know, most of all, what we need to hear is that reassuring verdict of such an open and repentant prayer. "I tell you that this man went home justified," in verse 14. He stood in the presence of God, now not as a despised and condemned criminal, but as a beloved and accepted child. Justified by faith, he could now have peace with God not the peace of the Pharisee, the self-manufactured fiction which would one day all collapse around him in his horror on that day of judgment. No, it's a peace with God based on God's own irreversible, incontestable declaration of pardon through Jesus' blood. So what sort of righteousness, we must ask ourselves, do we seek? A righteousness of our own that comes through our own moral efforts, or a righteousness from God that depends on faith? I'm going to end with some words from the theologian Karl Barth. And he says this: we dislike hearing that we are saved by grace alone. We don't really appreciate that God does not owe us anything, that we are bound to live from his goodness alone, that we are left with nothing but the great humility of a child presented with many gifts. To put it bluntly, we do not like to believe. But, friends, believe we must. Believe in the greatness of the merciful heart of God. Believe in Jesus' amazing sacrifice. And believe most of all, perhaps, in the truth of that extraordinary promise: everyone who exalts himself will be humbled, but he who humbles himself will be exalted. In the topsy-turvy world of heaven and in the parables of Jesus, it's the poor who are rich, the humbled who are great. In the paradox of parables and a landscape of the kingdom of God, the way up is down. Amen.
Thanks, John, for this morning, for bringing us God's words. We appreciate it's not been the easiest of weeks. We pray for you, for Jane, for Daniel. We pray that God's healing touch will be upon your family. Now, here's Irene with our prayers for the fellowship.
It's fellowship prayer time again, so let's pray. Lord, you are our rock, our fortress. You are our help when we need you, and so we come to give you thanks for answered prayer. And we also come with our concerns for those whom we love. So we bring these people, Lord, our family and our friends before you, confident that you will take care of them. So we pray for those people who are still working from home. We ask you to bless their efforts, and we also remember those many folk who are working so hard in the NHS. We thank you for all of them. We pray, Lord, for those receiving their vaccinations just now, and we ask that you'd keep them safe. We pray, Lord, for those who are ill, particularly we remember those who are ill with COVID, and we pray for Jane and Daniel. Particularly Jane, who seems to have a bad dose of COVID. And we ask that you would bless John as he looks after them. So you would just put your hand on the whole of the Kitson family. We pray for those, Lord, who are terminally ill, whose hope perhaps is growing dim. And we ask you to be close to them and to comfort them and their families in these difficult times. We pray, Lord, for those who are still mourning the loss of special people. We ask you to comfort them too. And Lord, there are those who suffer from day to day with mental health issues and struggle to have clear thoughts. We just ask that you would be with them. And we remember again, Lord, those who are lonely, who are missing their family and their friends. Be their friend, Lord. Lord, we all fall into some category or other, but we do need to pray for ourselves, and we just ask that you would keep us all well and safe, as you have done so far. We pray that we'd be strong in your power and we'd be humbled by your grace. and we ask that in this coming week we might share your love with others as you have shared your love with us. Bless us, we pray, in Jesus' name. Amen.
Thanks, Irene. Also thanks to Kath Richardson and John Kitson. Our final hymn is a modern take on a classic hymn that was written more than 350 years ago by a school teacher in Germany. His life was tragic in the classic sense, a life of great potential cut short by an untimely death aged just 30. However, he wrote 60 hymns. Most were hymns of joyful praise, even though they were written at a time when he was living under considerable stress. Several of his hymns have inspired Christians around the world for more than three centuries. Praise to the Lord the Almighty is based on Psalms 103 and 150. It was inspired not only by those Psalms, but also by the beauty of the hills and rivers that he experienced on his walks through the German countryside.
Praise to the Lord, the Almighty, King of creation. Oh, my soul, praise Him, for He is your help and salvation. Oh, you who hear, now to His temple draw near. Praise Him in glad
I'd like to close our time together with a prayer from the pen of John Birch. Ever-present God, you walk with us through good times and bad, mountaintop and valley deep. Your footsteps are guide, hands are support. Ever-present God, you are close to us when life is smooth or rough, in wholeness and brokenness. Your healing, our hope. Your touch, our desire. Ever-present God, bring comfort and peace and the warmth of your presence. And I shall fear no thing, for you are with me always. Thank you again for joining us. I'm going to leave you in the hands of our friends from the village chapel worship team with a gospel hymn that was also born out of a personal tragedy. 'Tis so sweet to trust in Jesus.
Trust in Jesus, just to take Him at His word, just to rest upon His promise, just to know, thus saith the Lord. Oh, how sweet to trust in Jesus, just to trust His